Thank you. I see a conflict of interest, particularly when somebody takes the data that I've shared and they intend to use the same thing, like they have the same objective as I had for that study. How should we avoid such kind of conflict of interest? Could we state in the sharing that this data was collected for this objective, and that would serve like a warning that anyone using it, that this was a bit more attention of the data.
So I would put all that inside your metadata. That's the purpose of your data set. So on the very last page of your metadata section of IPT, there's a purpose section that would clearly indicate why it was that you collected the data, what was your purpose. It's not to say that other people can't extend on what you've done, or that if you've done, either if you have a count on the children, but it's not to say that if you've done ecological niche modeling with the species, that that's the only ecological niche modeling that can ever be done with your data. Is that your question?
To some extent, I mean, I imagine you spend a lot of
time. I'm imagining you spend a lot of time in the field collecting data and you're not publishing. You're not like published at the top of it and you're still working on the publication. But then, you move quickly to share that kind of data. And somebody jumps into it and probably they publish for your publication without.
So you've been shown this week a very easy solution to that. Those key fields or those key data records that are part of your study, publish them, you don't let them go. You indicate that there's more information out there. And those are, what was it, reserved fields, or what's the name of them?
Just information withheld.
Information withheld. So that way, the data are out there, which happens to you or to your institution, but nobody can always say swoop you. And that gives you the time you need to write your publication. So it's a very easy solution. And there are institutions that may be working on a big institutional project where they may reserve thousands of records or hundreds of thousands of records for a decade while they finish up that, you know, birds of X. Okay? Perfect as well. Science takes time, and I may go out and get a key observation, a key data set, and I may spend all the resources that I can accumulate to get to that place and get those observations, or I might bring some special expertise that, as you say, somebody else can just grab and publish. So, don't serve those data. Protect your interests. Use your personal analysis. So it's a very easy solution, and yet you're still working in the spirit of data sharing and publication.
And it could prevent somebody from going out to the same spot someday and duplicating your efforts, wasting their time. We don't want to waste people's time and duplicate efforts. Who is first?
Our data
That's a really good question. Does Jinder get paid for the number of records that it has in its database, in its index? No, it does not. We started as a mega science initiative to make the information freely and openly available for the benefit of science. And that information should be used for non-profit research, for example. There should be no economic gain in theory from the data that's there. So if anything, we are trying to get more value to the original owners of data so that they can gain exposure, so that undigitized collections can get the interest of people in the world so that they can come and give funding perhaps. But there's no economic gain to GBIF per se, but the more success that we have in growing the index and the quality of the index and the number of publications that come out of this information, the better it is for GBIF, for sure. If there's nothing beneficial to the index, then we would cease to exist. I'll pass it to Tam because it looks like he wants to say something.
These are issues that are close to the heart. None of these networks is a for-profit endeavor. So why would they want to add another 40 data sets or 40 institutions serving multiple data sets? Well, because as Kyle said, these are research infrastructures. And the whole reason for their being, reason for their funding, the reason for everything, is to provide an infrastructure to support research. The same as we have an internet, that's a research infrastructure in part. Same as we have libraries. Well, these data networks are becoming quite a critical and irreplaceable element of the research infrastructure. And so, your data in particular are valuable because they're a piece of the puzzle. Maybe the plants of a particular region or the primates of another region. But as I showed in my talk, it's only when you put together the puzzle across many institutions, many countries, and many taxa that you really can get a full picture of biodiversity.
Thank you very much for your questions.
Thank you. I'm sorry I have to go back to a question from John, the owner of the data. I did get a problem. For example, I'm working here at a big institution like DCDP, and we are collecting a lot of data. Now, who would be the owner of that data?
That is a very complex question. John was pointing out a very peculiar situation in which we in the United States are, and particularly the University of California at Berkeley, because they've done a lot of work historically in national parks. And it comes down to, John, correct me if I'm wrong, it comes down to the fact that when we were granted permits to work in national parks, the specific wording was that the ownership of the specimens and data stayed with our national park system. So that was a specific agreement. It's not a general situation. That fair to say?
I believe that's true.
It's still being negotiated. In general, when, for example, my institution accessions a specimen, okay, that is a process of taking legal ownership. And that process of taking legal ownership is both a responsibility and a benefit, which is to say, if we take legal ownership and there is some illegal nature to the specimen that was collected without permits, for example, then the university is legally responsible. Okay? And the benefit is that specimen belongs to the University of Kansas, just like this shirt room can use my shirt, but please, at the end of the day, give me the chair. Right? It's still mine, even if you use it. Right? So what Kyle's given us with this lecture on licensing is essentially a framework that says the owner of the specimen, of the data, I should say, makes those data available to the broader community under these circumstances. Leave the chair, you're done. Okay? And so that's one licensing solution. I agree that it's probably the most appropriate. There are many, many, many ways to license the use of property. So think about it, if you rent an apartment, you sign a contract. The owner is giving you certain uses. But if you're renting an apartment, you can't knock the building down, right? The owner's going to say, hey, that was my building. So that contract says, this is what you can do, and this is what I will do. You can do it, you can do it, I have to do it, you have to do it. So this is just another contract. Okay, so it's a license. As to who owns the specimen, going back to the National Park question, you have to look at the specific licensing agreement under which those specimens were kept. So when I did recently an expedition to Mongolia, the licensing agreement was very simple. It was, you come, you do this legally, and you can have the specimens. But we have decades of work now in the Philippines, and there the agreement is the specimens remain the property of the government of the government of the Philippines. You can have them on long-term loan, but they are legally property of the Philippines. So each agreement, each situation under which you obtain a specimen or observation is different. By the same token, let's imagine there's no specimen. And you just go out and you accumulate data. Maybe you're watching birds or noting down species of plants. My question would be, what does your contract say? Somebody's paying you, right? Maybe it's a university. If the contract has a clause, any data and materials accumulated during your employment are the exclusive property of the University of X, it's very clear. But if you as a private citizen go out, not employed by anybody, the data will work. Okay? It's complex.
Yeah, thank you. I understand GPF is the global network for publishing data, but besides being global, anything else, why is it recommended?
So, yes, it's global, and we try and work with as many countries as we can. So that will eventually extend to every corner of the earth and help countries understand how to better manage their data. And where we are now today, we hope to be in the future. We hope to build capacity in those countries. So, we are global in a sense, but we are not everywhere yet. And that's part of the reason why I'm here and why the rest of the panel of experts are here. We're holding this workshop is so that this knowledge and capacity that we're trying to extend globally, we're not there yet, so that we can extend that to as wide as possible. And so that you guys can all go back to your institutions with new knowledge and skills to be able to add more information and biodiversity to the public domain for the wider use of science. I don't have a longer answer than that. And
everybody feel free to jump in. But in answer to your question, this course is not specific to GDEC. Okay? We have people here who are working with VertNet, which contributes data to GDEC, but is a separate entity.
this course is completely independent, okay? Project director is a professor at the university, and funding comes from an independent foundation. Now, why have we seen GBIF, GBIF, GBIF? Because GBIF has been a very active player in this field. It has it's serving access to the largest data set, or the largest set of data sets in the world, and it's been very active in developing